Welcome to our channel, Upper Public School, Kalburgi. So today in our biology class, we are dealing with the first chapter, Life Processes. So before beginning with the chapter, let us understand the definition of the chapter or the definition of the title, Life Processes. Life processes can be defined as the activities performed by organism to stay alive. So, any activities which are helping organisms to stay alive or to live or to survive, so those activities are called as life processes. So, example for life processes are nutrition, respiration, transportation and excretion. So, it is not that only these are called as life processes, but any processes which are helping an organism to live, so those are called as life processes. Those are called as life processes. So under life processes, we are not including reproduction, because reproduction is not essential for living, but it is very crucial or it is very vital for continuing our race. It is helping an organism to continue its generations or its race, but it is nowhere helping an organism to live. Therefore, reproduction is not included under life processes. With this little information about life processes, now let us begin with all these life processes one by one, starting with the nutrition first. Nutrition. Let us now understand the definition of the word nutrition. Nutrition can be simply defined as the mode of gaining nutrients. The mode of gaining nutrients in the form of food, that is called as nutrition. So, I have used the word nutrients in the definition. The mode of gaining nutrients in the form of food is called as nutrition. And now let us understand what you mean by nutrients. Nutrients. So what are nutrients? The substances which are required by an organism for its growth and development. So such a substance may be called, or it is called as, the nutrients. The substances required by an organism for its growth and development. You already know what you mean by growth and development. So apart from this growth and development, for various other activities like the repairing of the broken tissues, okay, and some other functions, nutrients are also required. So in common, we define the nutrients as the substances required by an organism for its growth and development. Now, we are already aware of the different types of nutrients, that is plant nutrients and animal nutrients. Plants mostly gain their nutrients in the form of minerals, in the form of their minerals. And in animals, the nutrients differ. And in animals, the nutrients differ. So in animals, we are classifying nutrients into five groups, starting with the carbohydrates, protein, lipid, then minerals, then vitamins. So when we have rice, we get carbs out of it. Carbs means carbohydrates out of it. When we have dal, we get protein out of it. When we have meat, oil, ghee, butter and all those fatty items, we get lipid out of it. So when we have vegetables, minerals and vitamins we get. Of course, when we have fruits also, we gain some minerals and some vitamins. So these are the five group of nutrients which we are having in the animal nutrition. So let us not much concentrate on the different types of nutrients. So we will only concentrate on different types of nutrition, and we are classifying nutrition broadly into two types. One is one is autotrophic mode of nutrition. And the second one is heterotrophic mode of nutrition. The first one is autotrophic mode of nutrition and the second one is heterotrophic mode of nutrition. So first let us understand the meaning of the word autotrophic mode of nutrition and heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Autotrophic and heterotrophic, both these words are derived from the Greek. Okay, so the word autos or auto refers to self synthesis, okay, or they are independent, they are not dependent upon anyone. So those are called autotrophs, or the mode of nutrition where an organism self synthesizes its food. So such organisms are called autotrophs, and such mode of nutrition is known as autotrophic mode of nutrition. Such mode of nutrition is known as autotrophic mode of nutrition. Auto refers to self, trophy refers to synthesis. So this is about the autotrophs. And definition of autotrophs: the organisms which does not depend upon others for their food, but they prepare their own food. So you can simply define it as the organisms which are capable of synthesizing their own food, they are called autotrophs. And then coming to heterotrophs, heteros refers to different, trophy refers to synthesis. That means they are depending upon different sources for their nutrition, therefore they are called as heterotrophs. Therefore they are called as heterotrophs. So how do we define this heterotrophic mode of nutrition? Heterotrophic mode of nutrition can be simply defined as the mode of nutrition where an organism depends upon other organisms for its food. So such a mode of nutrition may be called as heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Now, once again, we'll deal with the autotrophic mode of nutrition. So here, under autotrophic mode of nutrition, we are classifying autotrophic mode of nutrition further. So when we classify autotrophic mode of nutrition, we have two types of autotrophic mode of nutrition. That is, first one is photosynthesis and second one is chemosynthesis. So what do you mean by photosynthesis and what do you mean by chemosynthesis? Let us understand now. So, definition of photosynthesis: the process of preparation of food using sunlight and some other materials is by green plants is known as photosynthesis. It is the generalized definition which you have heard from your primary classes. That is the process of preparation of food using sunlight, chlorophyll, carbon dioxide, water by green plants is known as photosynthesis. But for grade 10, you are expected to give one more definition. That is the process of converting radiant solar energy into chemical energy in the form of food is known as photosynthesis. The word photo refers to light, and usually the light source is from the sun. That is sunlight. So the preparation of food involving sunlight is known as photosynthesis. And it is performed by green plants. Then coming to chemosynthesis, what do we mean by chemosynthesis? I think most of the people are not familiar with the word chemosynthesis. Of course, chemosynthesis is also a type of autotrophic mode of nutrition. But the only difference between photosynthesis and chemosynthesis is the source of energy here is light, but here the source of energy is chemical. So most of the bacterias or some group of bacterias, that is especially the bacterias which are found deep under the sea, okay, they are very close to the seabed. That is several miles from the surface of the water. So there few group of bacteria live, and those group of bacteria, they cannot undergo photosynthesis, but they undergo chemosynthesis. What do you mean by chemosynthesis? The process of preparing their own food by using the chemicals as a source of energy. So usually in ocean we have current vents or volcanic vents we have. That is, volcanic eruptions will be there deep under the seabed, and in during that volcanic eruptions several carbon like several chemicals are available in that volcanic eruptions, and they are like phosphorus it may be, methane it may be, sulfur it may be, or any carbon related compound it may be. So using those chemicals, these group of bacteria, they synthesize their own food. So that is, chemosynthesis can be defined as the process of preparation of food by mediating into some inorganic chemical reactions. By involving in some inorganic chemical reactions, these organisms prepare their own food. So let us not focus much on chemosynthesis, but only we will concentrate on photosynthesis. Just it is for understanding. Chemosynthesis is only for the increasing knowledge or enhancing knowledge, that's it. So we'll stress only upon chemosynthesis in this chapter. Excuse me. Then coming to heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Under heterotrophic mode of nutrition, once again, heterotrophic mode of nutrition is classified into three types, that is, starting with holozoic mode of nutrition, parasitic mode of nutrition, saprophytic or saprotrophic mode of nutrition. So these are the three different types of heterotrophic mode of nutrition, that is holozoic, parasitic, saprophytic or saprotrophic. What do you mean by holozoic mode of nutrition? Holozoic mode of nutrition means intaking the food or engulfing the food, digesting it and extracting nutrients out of it and utilizing it for synthesis of energy. So that mode of nutrition is known as holozoic mode of nutrition. So most of the members, that is right from primitive group of organisms to higher organisms, they go with the holozoic mode of nutrition. Amoeba is also a holozoic organism, and we human beings are also example for this holozoic mode of nutrition, because we intake our food, we digest it, then we utilize that nutrients for the energy production. So that is holozoic mode of nutrition. It is a mode of nutrition where an organism intakes the food, digests the food, then utilizes the nutrients for energy synthesis. That is known as holozoic mode of nutrition. Then the second one is parasitic mode of nutrition. So what do you mean by parasitic mode of nutrition? It is a mode of nutrition where an organism depends upon other living organism, for its nutrition, for its food and shelter. So such organism is known as a parasite. Okay. So that organism is known as a parasite, and this mode of nutrition is known as parasitic mode of nutrition. So other living organism is called as host. So one organism will depend upon other living organism for its food and shelter. When it is depending upon its the other host for its food and shelter, definitely it is going to cause some or the other problem to that host, and therefore that is known as parasitic mode of nutrition. So parasitic mode of nutrition can be defined as the mode of nutrition where an organism depends upon the other living host for its food and shelter, causing harm to it, So parasitic mode of nutrition, so we can broadly classify parasitic mode of nutrition into two groups. that is ectoparasites and endoparasites. Ectoparasites and endoparasites. What do you mean by ectoparasites? Ectoparasites refers to the parasitic organisms living on your body. So they are called as ectoparasites, and best example for the ectoparasites is the ticks. The ticks you usually find on your domestic animals or domesticated pets, like it may be cow, buffalo, dog, cat. So you find ticks over them. So they are blood sucking organisms. So they are present over the surface, on the surface of the body. Therefore they are called ectoparasites. They are called as ectoparasites. And what do you mean by endoparasites? The parasites living within the body, they are all called as endoparasites. Like the members of Aschelminthes and Platyhelminthes, they are well known for their parasitic mode of nutrition. So they are living in our body. That is especially in the intestine. They take away all the nutrients, especially in infants or small kids. So where they are playing in some soil and mud, so they accidentally those organisms come in contact with these kids or infants, then they live in their intestine for several days and they are causing malnutrition problems related to the growth, that is malnutrition and all those things. And when you consult a pediatrician, he will give a drug which will kill, or he will give you the deworming agent which will kill the endoparasites. When the endoparasites are all killed, so your body will be having sufficient amount or adequate amount of nutrients. Therefore, you can continue your growth and development after that. So this is about the ectoparasites and endoparasites, which is the extending concept of the parasitic mode of nutrition. After this parasitic mode of nutrition, now let us deal with the saprotrophic mode of nutrition or saprophytic mode of nutrition. So what do we mean by saprotrophic mode of nutrition or saprophytic mode of nutrition? Let us understand. The only difference between parasitic mode of nutrition and the saprotrophic mode of nutrition is that parasites depend upon the other living bodies, whereas the saprotrophs depends upon other dead bodies, the dead and decaying matters, organic matters. So the organic matter which is decomposing. So on such decomposing organic matters only, the saprophytes or the organisms which are having saprotrophic mode of nutrition, they gain their nutrients. So saprotrophic mode of nutrition can be defined as, it is the mode of nutrition where an organism feeds upon dead and decaying organic matter. That mode of nutrition is known as saprotrophic mode of nutrition or saprophytic mode of nutrition. The best example for saprophytic mode of nutrition is the members belonging to kingdom Mycota. They are belonging to kingdom Mycota. So kingdom Mycota, you are all familiar with the kingdom fungi. Okay, kingdom fungi and kingdom Mycota are one and the same, and mushroom, toadstool, so these are all the examples, yeast, okay, Rhizopus stolonifera, these are all the several examples for the fungus which are belonging to kingdom Mycota. So almost all these fungi or all the fungi, they are saprotrophic in mode of nutrition. That means they do not feed upon living bodies, but they feed upon only decaying or decomposing organic matter. Okay, when the bread is fresh, you do not find the growth of fungus on the fresh bread. Or you keep it moist for few days, that is 2 or 3 days covered, then you find the growth of fungus on that. That means what? It is not depending upon the fresh one, or it is depending upon the decomposing matters only. Therefore, this is saprophytic mode of nutrition. Holozoic, engulfing, digesting, extracting nutrients, then utilizing. Parasitic, depending upon other living body for its food and shelter, causing harm to it. Saprophytic, depending upon the dead and decaying matter. Is that clear? So you don't find growth of mushroom on normal wood. Okay, when you cut a trunk of a tree, or when you just cut or chop down a tree, so immediately you do not find growth of mushroom on the tree, but when it is left out there for several days, that is specially when it is exposed to some monsoons or rainy seasons, soon you find the growth of mushrooms on it. So the growth of mushrooms on it is indicating that that log or the wood is decomposing day by day. Is that clear? So this is known as saprophytic mode of nutrition. So we have finished about autotrophic mode of nutrition and heterotrophic mode of nutrition under the heading nutrition. Now in this class we are going to deal with the autotrophic mode of nutrition, and then we'll finish off autotrophic mode of nutrition taking example of plants, that is photosynthesis we are going to deal. Then after dealing with the photosynthesis, we will deal with the heterotrophic mode of nutrition, that is holozoic mode we will be dealing. Then parasitic mode, I will be explaining you one concept. Then saprotrophic mode, one concept will be explained. So in this chapter, so you need to have already explained you about parasitic and saprophytic with the example, so no need to explain there. But holozoic also no need to explain there. So we will be dealing with the next part, that is nutrition in amoeba. Then we'll deal with the nutrition in the paramecium. Then finishing off these two microbes, we will deal with the autotrophic mode of nutrition, that is photosynthesis. So we will deal with the photosynthesis. Then we will deal with the essentials of photosynthesis. Then after finishing about the essentials of photosynthesis, we will be dealing with the mechanism of photosynthesis. We will be dealing with the mechanism of the photosynthesis. Then after finishing the mechanism of photosynthesis, we will be dealing with the next, that is heterotrophic mode of nutrition. And heterotrophic mode of nutrition, we will be dealing about the amoeba and paramecium, as I have already said you. Then after finishing amoeba and paramecium, we will be dealing with the human nutrition. Okay, human nutrition. So before dealing with all this, let us understand the various steps involved in the process of nutrition. Various steps involved in the process of nutrition. The five important steps involved in the process of nutrition are as follows. The first one is ingestion. Followed by digestion. Followed by absorption. Absorption. Followed by assimilation. Then followed by ejection. So ingestion is intake of food, that is we intake our food through our buccal cavity, then we digest it in our alimentary canal, then in our intestine we absorb, then we absorb the nutrients and those nutrients are assimilated by our cells, and after all these processes the undigested waste material along with metabolic wastes are all ejected out of the body. So these are the five important steps involved in the process of nutrition. It may be plant nutrition or it may be animal nutrition. All this nutrition involves these important five steps. It is ingestion, digestion, absorption, assimilation and ejection. So we are winding the class with the nutrition here. In the next class, we would be dealing about the process of nutrition in plants. The process of nutrition in plants, that is autotrophic mode of nutrition. Example, we will be dealing with the photosynthesis over there. Till then, thank you. Please do subscribe our channel, Appa Public School, Kalburgi, for more interesting and subject related videos. Thank you. previous class we have finished till the classification of modes of nutrition, that is autotrophic mode of nutrition and heterotrophic mode of nutrition. So under autotrophic mode of nutrition we are only going to deal with the photosynthesis. So let us define what do you mean by photosynthesis. Photosynthesis can be defined as the process of converting radiant solar energy into chemical energy in the form of food. This is known as photosynthesis. So let us understand the essentials required for photosynthesis. So what are the essentials required for photosynthesis? Let us understand. And before understanding the essentials required for photosynthesis, let us understand the significance of photosynthesis. What is the significance? What is the importance of photosynthesis? Photosynthesis is a vital process by which plants require, plants prepare their own food. Along with the preparation of food, they also generate a gaseous waste, that is oxygen. And this oxygen is a crucial gas for sustaining life. It is an important gas for sustaining life. So this is the important significance of the photosynthesis. Preparation of food, that is providing nutrition to the plants, then providing atmospheric oxygen. Apart from that, they are also having role in biogeochemical cycles, that is utilization of carbon dioxide, releasing oxygen, and also maintaining the temperature of the earth, and also maintaining the temperature of the earth. So there are the various other significances of this vital process called as photosynthesis. So let us now deal with the essentials of photosynthesis, or raw materials required for the process of photosynthesis. The raw materials required for the process of photosynthesis are the light, then the chlorophyll, next one is carbon dioxide, and the last one is water. So these are the four essential elements, or four essentials which require to carry out the process of photosynthesis. Now let us understand the sources of all these materials required to carry out the process of photosynthesis. The light. The main source of light in the process of photosynthesis is through sun. Okay, so the sunlight is the major source of energy required for carrying out of photosynthesis process. Then chlorophyll. So as we have already said you that all green plants do perform photosynthesis, that means that green plants have the cells, and in those cells we are having a cytoplasmic organelle called as the plastids, and in the plastids there are various types of plastids like chloroplast, chromoplast and leucoplast. Chloroplast has a pigment called as chlorophyll, and it is responsible for the color characteristics of the leaves, that is green color. So the plants are green in color because of the presence of the pigment called as chlorophyll inside the plastid, that is chloroplast. Okay, then that is the source. Then we are having carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide we get it from the atmosphere. Whereas water we are getting it from the underground part, that is from the soil. So these are the major sources of the essentials required to carry out photosynthesis. So photosynthesis is a qualitative and quantitative one. It is a qualitative and quantitative one. That means what? The photosynthesis process depends upon the quality and quantity of light. Okay, the quality and quantity of light. So quality of light is intensity of light. Intensity of light is a qualitative measure, whereas the duration of light is a quantitative measure. Okay, it is a quantitative measure. So intensity of light. So the light need to be of a particular intensity so that the process of photosynthesis can be carried out. If it is not of that intensity, the photosynthesis process cannot be performed. And even the intensity is more also, then the photosynthesis process cannot occur. Then duration of light also depends. It is also the factor which is going to affect the rate of photosynthesis. So this is all about the significance, then essentials required, then the concept of photosynthesis. Now let us understand about the mechanism of photosynthesis. So in the mechanism of photosynthesis, there are mainly two types of reactions, the light reaction and the dark reaction, the light reaction and the dark reactions. So in these two light and dark reactions, the various chemical processes takes place. Therefore, ultimately the food is produced. With the chemical equation for photosynthesis is CO2 plus H2O in presence of light, that is sunlight, and chlorophyll produce chemical energy, that is in the form of food, that is glucose, with the formula C6H12O6 plus O2 plus H2O. So this is the generalized chemical equation for photosynthesis, where we are using raw materials like carbon dioxide and water in presence of sunlight, and with the activity of chlorophyll, we are producing sugar or glucose with the chemical formula C6H12O6 plus O2, that is oxygen, and water H2O. This is the generalized chemical equation or normal chemical equation for the process of photosynthesis. So the first and foremost step in the mechanism of photosynthesis is photolysis of water. The water molecule is broken down, and then next step, what is happening? Carbon dioxide is fixed, or is carbon dioxide is involved in the reaction. Okay, so after this carbon dioxide is involved in the reaction, the next step is preparation of glucose and elimination of water as well as oxygen. So both the process, that is breaking down of the water and fixing up of carbon dioxide, takes place in light reaction, whereas further utilization of these two chemicals to produce the glucose takes place in the dark reactions. So let us not concentrate more about the light and dark reactions, which we are having in your higher studies. So there we can deal with these two different types of chemical reactions, that is light reaction and dark reaction. So this is all about the process of photosynthesis. So now we will deal with the next part, that is heterotrophic mode of nutrition. So we have already finished now autotrophic mode of nutrition. So now we shall be dealing with the heterotrophic mode of nutrition. So under heterotrophic mode of nutrition, as I have already said you, we are going to deal with the three different modes of nutrition, that is holozoic mode of nutrition, parasitic mode of nutrition, and saprotrophic mode of nutrition. So we shall discuss about the parasitic, holozoic, and saprotrophic mode of nutrition in the earlier class. So now we shall be dealing with the holozoic mode of nutrition by taking example of amoeba. So how is amoeba intaking its nutrient? We are nutrition we are going to understand now. That is nutrition in amoeba. So nutrition in amoeba. Amoeba take its nutrition or take its nutrients by the process called as phagocytosis. Phagocytosis is a type of endocytosis. Phagocytosis is a type of endocytosis. So what happens in the nutrition? What happens with the nutrition in amoeba? So let us understand about nutrition in amoeba in short. So whenever amoeba, which is a unicellular organism with irregular shape, finds its food. So you might have a doubt that what would amoeba have? Amoeba would have the simple organisms such as algae. Whenever the amoeba finds the algae, this is the amoeba. So whenever this amoeba has or it finds its food material, that is algae. So what does this amoeba do? The amoeba will encircle the food material using its false arm-like structure called as pseudopodia. So in the second figure, you can clearly look at the false arm-like structures, pseudopodia encircling the algae. So they just encircle the food material using their false arm-like structures called as pseudopodia. Then after encircling the food material, that is algae, so slightly they dissolve their body structure, and then in the next figure you can look at this, that in a particular vacuole called as food vacuole, the ingested food material is digested there. The ingested food material is digested out in food vacuoles. Then the nutrients from this food vacuoles, they diffuse out into the cytoplasm. Then once the food is completely digested, then in the next process what happens? The undigested food material, whichever which is present in the body, so it is ejected out. It is ejected out by bursting out the membrane. Okay, by bursting out the membrane, the food material or the undigested food material is ejected out of the body. So in this picture, it is very clear that ingestion process is taking place, then digestion process is taking place, then absorption, assimilation, then ejection. Okay, all this thing is happening in the same process. So this process is known as the endocytosis and phagocytosis. Phagocytosis, which is a type of endocytosis. So amoeba is going to encircle its food using pseudopodia, and once it is encircling the food using the pseudopodia, it is going to digest in a particular vacuole called as food vacuole. Once it is going to digest in the food vacuole, the nutrients are diffused out into the cytoplasm, where the nutrients are utilized, and after utilization of those nutrients, and if whatever food material which is not digested or undigested food material is eliminated out of the body by rupturing the membrane, so you can clearly look at the image here, and you can imagine the process of ingestion, digestion, absorption, assimilation and ejection in the process of nutrition. This is all about nutrition in amoeba. So in the next class we would be dealing about nutrition in paramecium, and then we'll deal with the human nutrition in the upcoming class. Thank you.